Let's wait for 2 more minutes and then we may begin. Yes, Omkar, you can ask your question till we begin. You can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hello, how are you?
Hello. Good evening,
yes,
sir. I just wanted to know the approach if you're studying for the drug discovery in the context of chromosomal or inherited diseases. In which there is a problem in the defective protein due to the inheritance. So what can be our approach towards the particular, if the protein is responsible for a disease, so what can be our approach towards it? Yeah, thanks.
So you are asking me or?
Yes, sir, he's asking you.
I think Sonalika.
So it's a very yes, sir. It's a very
let him go through the presentation. Then he may get several answers.
Yes, sir. Exactly. So I thought that he has some technical question. That's why I asked you. So Omkar, we'll answer your question after the session, or maybe you'll get your answer during the session itself.
Sonalika, you may start now. Introducing the speaker.
Yes, sir. Let's begin.
So while others join.
Yes, sir. Sure. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, please.
So a very warm welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining today's webinar. We have Dr. Rami Reddy with us today, who would be giving an overview on computer-aided drug designing. I welcome you, sir. Also, I welcome Dr. Pallu Ridana with us. So before we start with the talk, I would want to introduce us. We are a US-based bioinformatics company who is working with multiple academic and commercial collaborators to develop easy-to-use analytical tools. And our mission is to make bioinformatics more accessible. Omics Logic research-based training programs are a result of close collaboration between Pine Biotech and numerous academic institutions that have participated in content evaluation, curriculum review, and project design. Omics Logic programs follow a project-based learning approach using research-grade tools to analyze data from top peer-reviewed journals. Omics Logic training has been completed by over 10,000 participants from 162 countries in over 300 workshops for 6 different specialization tracks, being oncology, infectious diseases, precision medicine, neuroscience, data science for biomedical data, and comprehensive training on omics data analysis. My name is Sonalika Ray, and I'm the Omics Logic Community Manager. And I'm responsible for daily interaction with thousands of users that are a part of our bioinformatics community, which is managed by Pine Biotech. Now, I would want to invite Dr. Reddy. Dr. Rami Reddy has wide spectrum of knowledge in the field of drug discovery and has made significant contributions in his 25 years of career. He is one of the few experts in the world in developing novel computational methods and their applications for drug discovery. He was responsible for successfully developing and commercializing a highly accurate computer-aided drug design technology intended to speed up drug discovery process. He is currently the co-founder and chairman of Rational Labs Incorporation, San Diego, California, USA, and Rational Labs Hyderabad, and also a visiting professor at the Center for Modeling, Simulation, and Design, Central University of Hyderabad. It would be my pleasure to invite Dr. M. Rami Reddy to give us an overview on computer-aided drug designing. Over to you, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir. So can you give me a
Yes, sir, you have the access, sir.
How do I get my presentation?
So there is this button on the screen which says share screen and an arrow. You have to click on it.
Okay, where is
So it would be on the bottom of the screen on Zoom.
Bottom of the screen, the green light.
Yeah, that's yes. What I am. Okay, so how do I get to Okay.
At the bottom, take the cursor to the bottom and then see.
Okay. Yeah, no,
yes, we can see your screen. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Sonalka, for a nice introduction. First, I would like to thank Professor Redana and other organizers for the invitation. So even though I worked on more than 20 different drug discovery projects using CAD methods, due to confidentiality, I cannot talk most of those projects. Today, I will discuss two successful projects. So this is the outline of my talk. First, I will give you a brief introduction to drug discovery, then flowchart for CAD, then type 2 diabetes, and how we are going to tackle that problem using fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase inhibitors, then flowchart for optimization of lead inhibitor, use of CAD methods for discovery of potent epiphase inhibitors, use of CAD methods for discovery of potent HIV protease inhibitors, then advantages and limitations of current CAD methods, and how we are going to eliminate some of those limitations using a novel quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics based free energy method. Then last, I will discuss about successful drugs which were discovered using CAD methods and also other approaches. It's not like pressing a button and getting the drug, but CAD played an important role. So this is the binding process. This is the ligand in the aqueous phase. This is the receptor in the aqueous phase. During binding process, the ligand is going to get into the cavity of the receptor by kicking the solvent out. There are two approaches for drug discovery. One is a traditional drug discovery. Another one is a rational drug discovery. Under rational drug discovery, there are two approaches. Structure-based drug discovery, when you know the structure of the target. And the second one is ligand-based drug discovery, when you don't know the structure of the target. So in traditional drug discovery, first what they do is screening up thousands of natural and synthetic compounds to identify active compounds. Once they identify the active compounds, medicinal chemists would make thousands of related analogs to improve the activity as well as the safest compound. So there are several limitations. The major limitations of this strategy is it does not reveal why a compound is active or inactive or how it might be improved. The other limitation is there's no guarantee the active compound is specific to the given target. Because of that, many compounds would fail in clinical studies. So basically, drug discovery is essentially a blind process, and drug discovery is based on the luck. So basically, you know, traditional drug discovery is like taking a lock and going to the locksmith and ask the locksmith to open the lock by closing his eyes. Naturally, he's going to try all the available keys in the store one after another. If he's lucky, he will find one. If he doesn't have lucky, he cannot find anything. Whereas rational drug discovery is similar to taking the lock and going to the locksmith and ask the locksmith to make the key for the lock. So naturally, he's going to see the size of that keyhole and he's going to pick up the most appropriate key to start with. That is like a lead. So once you start with that one, within 4 or 5 adjustment, he's going to make a perfect key to open that lock. So similarly, in the traditional drug discovery, most of the cases, you don't know the target, you don't know the binding site, you don't know the properties of the binding site. So basically, it's like a black box. Just you are throwing the darts. If you are lucky, you will hit one. If you don't have luck, you don't get anything. Whereas in rational drug discovery, you know the target, you know the structure of the target, you know the properties of the target. Once you have that information, it would be very easy to come up a new molecule which will fit into the target binding site. Okay. Rational drug discovery, I said, you know, I would be focusing mostly on structure-based drug discovery. So here, as I said, you know, target is known. 3D structure of a target is known in most of the cases. And properties of the binding site are known. That means where we have the hydrogen bond donor or acceptor groups, where you have hydrophobic, hydrophilic areas and volume of the active site. Once you have this type of information, we can take this lead compound, you can propose even hundreds or thousands of new analogs of a lead compound. So this is the time frame for drug discovery and development. Usually it takes 3 to 8 years to identify a clinical candidate. Once you get that candidate, and it takes 3 to 5 years to complete phase one to phase three, then NDA submission and FDA approval, it takes 1 to 2 years. Total time is 7 to 15 years, and it would cost anywhere between $250 million to $1 billion. So as you can see here, this white bar is investment in failed compounds. This blue is investment in successful compounds. So by looking at this chart, you can see most of the money is spent in failed compounds during lead optimization and also in phase three. Computationally, we cannot do much in phase three, but we can do a lot in lead optimization by using new techniques and using structure-based drug discovery. We can increase the successful rate here. That way, we can reduce the time and money during lead optimization. So our time and money will depend upon where you start your project. If you start at the gene level and go to DNA, RNA, protein, function of the protein, yes, and all those things, it would take $1 billion and 10 to 15 years. Of course, if you start with the lead, that will be much quicker and it won't cost that money. So our cost and time frame completely depends upon where you start your project. The next one is flowchart for CAD. So before you start computer-aided drug design, you need to get required hardware, software, and databases. Once you have that type of input, all those things, the first question one should ask is protein structure known? If the answer is no, obviously one has to use QSAR approaches. There is nothing but like a ligand-based approach. There 2D, 3D, then other approaches. Now, using any one of these approaches, one could suggest new analog of a lead compound using Farm-Pore model. If the answer for this question is either yes or no, doesn't matter. Still, one could propose new analogs of a lead compound using hydration-free energies, provided inhibitors bind to their enzyme in their hydrated form. Good examples are adenosine deaminase and cytidine deaminase targets. So the next approach is, if the answer for this question is yes, that means you know the structure of the target with complex. The first thing what one should do is generation of the computer model. So what I mean by generation of the computer model is, so almost all the packages do have a very good force field parameters for all 20 amino acids and 4 DNA bases and small organic molecules and also most of the drug molecules. When you go for novel molecules, that's where most of the drug companies are interested. Most of the companies don't have good force field parameters, except some companies like Schrodinger, where they have an extensive database. So obviously, one has to develop the parameters which are given in this equation. So this is related to the bonds, angles, torsions. This is non-bonded. This is hydrogen. So this is a tedious job. Later, I will come back to this one. Right now, we know one has to develop these parameters. So then second step is build missing atoms or residues. Whenever you get a crystal structure, you want to make sure so you don't have any holes in the protein. So you don't want any missing residues or loops or atoms. So if you see anything like that, you need to fill those things using homology model followed by Monte Carlo or multi-dynamic simulations. That is very important. The other step is assign histidine protonation state. In this case, you know, when the crystallographers solve the structure, they cannot assign the protons. Obviously, user has to look around this all histidines and see where the proton goes. All depends upon how you are going to get optimal interactions. Let us say you have the nitrogen here lone pair. If you see the carbonyl oxygen here, then you want to assign the proton here. If you see NH backbone like this, you don't want another proton here. So our bottom line is, so you got to assign the protons such that they would pick up optimal interactions with the protein residues. The other one is, so when the crystallographers solve this X-ray structure, they cannot see the difference between the electron density between the NH, nitrogen, and oxygen. So obviously, both look pretty same. So if they're very careful, they're going to look surroundings and they assign these things, nitrogen and oxygen. If they're not careful, they are going to assign this nitrogen and oxygen randomly. But user, before you use these residues for any predictions, you want to make sure you orient these groups such that they would pick up optimal interactions with the protein residues. Let us say, for example, you have a carbonyl oxygen sitting here. You don't want another oxygen here. You want to orient this NH2 this side. That way, you that would pick up good optimal interactions. So some of the commercial packages, they do have a good, some software which automated these things. Even, for example, even Schrodinger have the software that would automatically assign the protonation states and also orient these things. But my assessment is, even though they have the program, at the end, you are the user. So you want to get accurate results. So you can use that automation, but at the end, I would recommend going at least around that active site. You don't want any of these things screwed up. So you can look manually and make sure these are all oriented properly, even though you use the whatever the programs they have to assign these things. So the next one is characterize the active site. So once you know the active site, you got to characterize that one, where you have the hydrogen bond donor groups, like where you have the hydrogen bond acceptor groups, where is the hydrophobic and hydrophilic areas. So similar to this one. So these are all hydrophilic and these are all hydrophilic area, this is hydrophobic area. And what is the volume of the active site? So how many atoms we can fit in the binding site? This type of information would be very useful when you propose the new analogs. The next one is lead inhibitor known. If you know the lead inhibitor, you can take the lead inhibitor and optimize the lead. If you don't know the lead inhibitor, you got to use DeNovo design or HDS and database searches to get the lead. Next, I will go to those things. So here, you know, there are at least three approaches to get the lead compound. The first one is DeNovo molecular design. The second one is searching databases. Third one is combinatorial chemistry, high throughput screening. So in DeNovo molecular design, so target structure you need to have this target structure with known binding site active site. So once you have that information, there are several ways to get the lead. So sequentially adding or joining molecular fragments to a growing structure. The other approach is adding functionality to an appropriately sized molecular scaffold. Then the last one is by evaluating complete molecular structure. In this case, I will give an example. When I was working at Agron, who developed a molecular Monte Carlo simulation program, to validate that program, what we did was, we took the one protein, we removed one residue, then we filled that gap with all carbons. Through Monte Carlo simulations, we converted those carbons into non-carbons. Finally, we got whatever the residue we removed. That way, same thing, if you want to get you can fill all the binding site with all the carbons, you can convert into non-carbons by using Monte Carlo simulations. That takes a lot of time, and also it requires a lot of your common sense also. It's not like just pressing the button and that is not going to give you the final compound. You got to do a lot of other things. So the next approach is searching databases. For this also, you need to know the active site. So once you know the active site, there are a lot of commercial databases available, like a CST, which has more than 400,000 compounds, and ACD, and 500,000 compounds, comprehensive medicinal chemistry, these are all known drugs, we have more than 10,000, and DDR, these are all the drugs which are in phase 1 to phase 3, and also proprietary databases, you know, based on the size of your company, you may have 10,000, some big companies, they may have millions. So using any of these packages, and you can dock these molecules and get the hits or leads. So if you get hit, then slowly you can convert that hit into lead, okay? The third approach is when you don't know the structure of the target or even binding site. So under these circumstances, you got to use combinatorial chemistry using high throughput screening. Using this method, you can identify new leads or new hits. So the next one is type 2 diabetes and how we are going to tackle that problem using fructose 1 fructose 1,6 bisphosphatase inhibitors. So type 2 diabetes, so based on the survey, as up to 2020, there are more than 430 million people who are suffering with diabetes, and it is expected to grow to 580 million by 2030. So in India, it is about 90 million. It is official count. Unofficially, it could be much more than that. I was told in India, one in four people in Hyderabad, they have diabetes. So in China, this is official count. Unofficially, it could be much more than that. In US, about 30 million, about 9%. This is close to reality. And it costs more than $100 billion to treat direct or indirect effects of the diabetics. So these are the available drugs, oral drugs for treating diabetes. Unfortunately, more than 50% of the diabetic patients are not able to keep up their hemoglobin A1C less than 7%. That indicates there's a lot of scope for improving the existing drugs as well as for discovering novel drugs. So these are the diabetic abnormalities: relative insulin deficiency, the whole body, peripheral insulin resistance, muscle, elevated hepatic glucose in the liver. This is a UK prospective diabetic study. So this is a conventional yellow one. Conventional means taking good diet and doing good exercise. And this one is intensive sulfonylureas. So this is intensive metformin. It doesn't matter whatever you do. So after 5 years or 10 years, eventually you have to go to insulin. And unless you continuously doing rigorous exercise and follow the strict diet control. So these are the different classes. I'm not covering all the other classes. There are some classes are missing here. So out of these three classes, first one is insulin enhancers. So glucose lowering, modest. It doesn't work for 33% of the people. And insulin sensitizers, and also it doesn't work for 32% of people. And this one so far is good. Insulin, this is all completely dependent on production of the insulin. Same thing here, this is independent. That means as long as your body is producing some insulin, these two classes of drugs would work. If your body doesn't produce anything, these class of drugs won't work. Eventually, you have to go to insulin. So weight gain, significant, circumference, still we don't know. The tolerance, 70%, they can use for 5 years. So nowadays, you know, if they combine good exercise and diet, you know, they may be able to get away even 10 to 15 years. So this is unknown. Safety, some people, they get a hypoglycemia when they take drug and you don't eat properly. And whoever is taking this class of drugs, and they have to undergo liver toxicity once in 3 months. And some drugs like metformin, they have lactic acidosis, but most of the people don't have that problem. So this is the target protein for this diabetes, FEPS. A leading inhibitor is adenosine monophosphate. Indication is diabetes. So this is the structural information. This is a tetramer. Each monomer has 340 residues, total 1360 residues. This is a very large protein. Resolution 2.3, this is the structural information. It was solved by Professor Bill Lipscomb at Harvard. So this is the tetramer. This is one of those monomers. This is where this AMP binds. So this is the electrostatic surface. Wherever you see the green color, this is all hydrophobic area. Wherever you see this red, that's all hydrophilic. As you can see here, wherever you have the phosphate group, these are all hydrophilic. Whatever atoms you want to replace there, they got to be polar and charged. Otherwise, you lose binding affinity. Whereas this side, you can see this N1 and N3, there's no hydrogen bonds. Based on the surface, everything is hydrophobic. So you can replace these groups from non-polar groups, and you may be able to get this one. Even this side also is a quite a bit hydrophobic. So you can get rid of even the sugar. So even by just by looking this, this structure and its surface area and Sony with electrostatic potential, immediately you will get some ideas where we can make some changes. What are the changes are required and what type of changes we need to make? This will give just some idea when you look at this structure with this electrostatic potential surface. So same thing in 2D. As you can see here, we have this 6-amino has two hydrogen bonds, N7 has one hydrogen bonds, this PO3 has six hydrogen bonds. And this sugar, you know, basically it is not doing that much. So this is the lead compound. This is a micromolar inhibitor for FEPH. When you started this project, we defined two goals. One is to convert this phosphate into non-phosphate, because phosphates are not going to be stable. That's the number one goal. Number two goal is to improve the binding affinity from micromolar to subnanomolar. To achieve these two goals, we decided to use structure-based drug discovery or Russian drug discovery with the structure, okay? Then flowchart for optimization of a lead inhibitor. As I said earlier, you know, once you know the lead compound and you know the properties of the binding site where you have hydrogen bond donors, acceptors, and where you have the hydrophobic, hydrophilic areas, using that information and lead compound, you can propose even hundreds or thousands of the new unlocks of a lead compound. Just for the sake of argument, so I have the lead compound, that AMP. So I'm using that compound and using the properties of that binding site. Let us say I proposed about 100 new analogs. I don't want to go and synthesize all those 100 analogs. I want to get it up more than 90% of those analogs on the computer. Otherwise, it doesn't make any sense using all the computational methods and synthesizing all those compounds. So the way I eliminate 90% of those compounds on the computer is, first thing is, I'm going to do graphical analysis. Just I'm going to look graphically. If that doesn't fit in the binding site, I'm going to throw those molecules. Then I do conformation analysis. Then if it is going to bump with protein residues, I'm going to throw those molecules. Then I'm going to calculate the desolvation energy, because the desolvation energy plays a very important role in the binding process. So let us say if it costs a lot of desolvation, if those polar groups are not going to pick up good hydrogen bonds in the complex, so you don't want those molecules. When you have the two polar groups, which are cost, you are paying about 3 to 5 kcal to desolvate, if they are not going to gain more than that in the complex, it is not worth. So we get rid of those molecules. Then using the DOC. DOC is not really meant for predicting the binding affinities. So we can, using that one, we can throw a lot of junk out. Okay, using the simple tricks, we can get rid of 50% of those things. Out of 100, then we'll end up with 50 molecules. So out of those 50, so what I do is I take the all 50 compounds and minimize those things, both in the complex as well as in the aqueous phase, and calculate the interaction energies and the strain energies for all those 50 molecules and rank out them 1 to 50, then I will get rid of 20. Bottom 21, then I will end up with 30 molecules. Then I will take those 30 molecules, use the structure-based 3D UKCR approaches, rank order them 1 to 30, then I will get it up another 20. So I end up with 10 molecules. I take those 10 top molecules and do free energy calculation and rank order them 1 to 10. Then I will ask chemists to synthesize whichever is easier out of 10, all 10, it doesn't matter. So then once they synthesize, the biology guys are going to measure activity, then they look for the results promising. That means, did we get it better than where you started? Then again, the next step, if the answer is yes, go to yes. Then satisfied, that means we started micromolar, our goal is subnanomolar. If you achieve that one, then go, take that compound and go for development. If not, you're going to repeat again. You take the best out of all those 10 molecules, and if possible, you can get another crystal structure, use that crystal structure and go through the same process again. Like that, you know, within 5 or 6 in a sense, you may be able to achieve your goal. Okay? The next one is use of CAD methods for discovery of potent APIs inhibitor. So there are four methods. So they are not, even though they're all are used for predicting binding affinities, so each one has its own limitations. So first one is docking and scoring. This is a crude estimation. Normally this program is not meant for predicting binding affinities. This program is meant for only for screening the molecules and throw a lot of junk when you have millions of compounds. So here, you know, for just for the sake of arguments, I'm showing all those things, whatever agreement you can get when you use these different methods for a given set of parameters. But for that purpose, I'm showing here. So as I said, our goal was to convert this phosphate into non-phosphate. To achieve that goal, we proposed this 2 to 5 molecules because these are all non-phosphate. The second one is we wanted to see the what is the role of this 3 polar groups on the sugar ring. So that's why we proposed these 3. Then we wanted to see what is the role of this N1 and 3. That's where we substituted a lot of non-polar molecules, 9 to 17. And also we want to understand what is the role of this 6-amino. So we proposed for that one, these 3 compounds. Then what is the role of this one? So before you even I do anything, I want to understand which atom is really critical for the binding affinity, which hydrogen bond is really critical for the binding affinity so that I don't touch those things, okay? So I proposed more than 100 molecules here for this, for the presentation purpose. I selected 22 molecules. I'm going to use the same 22 molecules for all those 4 methods. And I will show you what type of results one can expect using different methods, assuming you have good force field parameters, okay? So these are the results using different dock programs. So this is AutoDock, Glide, Surplex Dock, and this is free energy calculated molecular mechanics methods. This is the free energy. This is experimental number. So as you can see here, you know, even though we are able to get qualitative agreement with experimental results, but still we are missing about 4 to 5 cases. We didn't even get the qualitative agreement. Overall, out of all these programs, not just like this course, if you consider the other parameters, the GLIDE showed the much better than other 2 DOC programs when compared to these ones. One of the problems with these DOC programs, you know, even though we get the qualitative agreement, when it comes to the quantitative, they're off by quite a bit. So that's why, as long as you are looking, qualitative means sometimes, you know, when even -10, -100, even -1000, all are qualitative. But sometimes we got to give some value the quantity also. Even though we are in the same side of the sign, but it doesn't mean much. But overall, out of all these packages, I think that is published in this paper. It was done by Kumar. And I think all the details are discussed in this paper. Our conclusion was the GLIDE was the best out of all these 3 packages. So next one, advantages, provides crude estimates of binding affinities. These calculations are very fast. Limitations, binding affinities are estimated using crude estimates of energies. Entropy contribution is not included. Results depend based on the docking program. So, and also most important thing is your results depend on what type of molecular mechanics force fields you are using, what type of charges you are using, what type of parameters you are using. This is key. Okay, the next one is molecular mechanics calculations. So here, so this equation shows, this is the Gibbs free energy is directly related, this is enthalpy and entropy, and this is directly related to the experimental binding constants. So this enthalpy is decomposed into energy and volume term. Again, this see in this molecular mechanics and DOC programs, just they take in molecular mechanics, they take this, they ignore this entropy and they ignore this volume term. Just they take this energy and they call it as a free energy. So one of the major problems in Malcolm mechanics using NRCs is when you minimize your inhibitor in the solvent as well as in the complex. In the solvent, it is not that bad, but in the complex, when you minimize, you know, if you stop your minimization at 1,000 steps, you get one number. If you stop your minimization at 2,000 steps, you get another number. At 3,000 steps, you get another number. And also, it is very hard to get real convergence to stop that one. So somewhere you got to stop. So unfortunate thing is when you take the total energies of the system, so between 1,000 steps and 2,000 steps, you are going to see hundreds of kcal difference. When you see such a big change, you know, they won't make any sense. In order to avoid that problem, what I did was, so I don't want to take the total energy of the system. So here, and I'm calling it delta E2 and delta E1. In a minute, I'm going to show you what I mean by delta E2 and delta E1. So the delta E2 is delta E inter and delta E2 intra. So the way I calculate delta E2 inter is I minimize inhibitor 2 in complex and calculate the interaction energies of that inhibitor with the surrounding residues. I don't want to take the total energy. Same thing, I minimize that inhibitor 2 in the solvent and take all the interaction energies. The difference between these two will give the inter. Here, this one is I take the strain energy, intramolecular energy of the inhibitor 2 after minimization. Same thing, intramolecular energy of the inhibitor 2 in solvent. The differences between these two will give the delta E2. So when you combine these two, that will give the delta E2. So this will eliminate big changes in the energies. Because now if you take the total energy of the system in the complex minimization, it's going to be thousands of kcal. And also when you look at the differences between one molecule and another molecule, based on where you stop it, you are going to see hundreds of kcal. So those numbers won't make any sense. So using this way, we are eliminating the large numbers. And also, even though this is not perfect, this is the best way of handling those energies. So same thing I can do, similar thing for inhibitor one, calculating inter and intra, the differences. So this is related to the inhibitor two, this is inhibitor one, and this will give the delta E binding. Then we can compare these things for all those 22 molecules. So there are a couple of things one has to take care of when you minimize these things. We developed a four-stage protocol. First thing, you know, we take that AMP and make a new analog. Let us say you added another functionality on the top of the AMP. When you do those things, what one should do is, and also when you put that one in the solvent, and naturally, you know, there will be a lot of solvent molecules which are going to get into the closer to that inhibitor. So when you minimize the whole thing one together, the solvent can push that solute this side and that side. In order to avoid those type of problems, what we did was we fixed inhibitor and we minimize only solvent molecules. That means the solvent molecules would adjust with respect to that inhibitor without, because inhibitor is not going to move anywhere. Then second step we do is we minimize only the hydrogens. That means all the hydrogens will adjust with respect to the heavy atoms. Then third step is we minimize the solvent and modified ligand. Let us say, that means we want to keep the original molecule as it is, whatever the group we modified and all solvent. So that, you know, that is not going to have any effect on the original molecule. Then last stage, we are going to minimize everything. So that way, you know, we are going to avoid a lot of artifacts. So same thing in the solvent and complex. Okay, these are the results. So this is the energies calculated using that method I showed you. These are all based on the intermolecular energies and intramolecular energies. Okay, this is not like based on the total energies. So these are the numbers calculated using free energy methods. except the three cases, you know, we got most of the cases, we got good agreement wherever you have the experimental numbers. So provides qualitative estimates of relative binding affinities. These calculations are very fast. Limitations, relative binding energies are estimated using only relative energies. Entropic contribution is not included. Results depend based on length of the minimization. Again, same problem here. If you don't have good parameters, garbage in, garbage out. This is all important. The third approach is structure-based 3D QSAR. So here we can get semi-quantitative estimates for relative binding affinities. Okay, it's like a similar to the QSAR. Here you are using more realistic variables. It's not like since we have the X-ray structure here, that's what we call this 3D QSAR, the structure-based 3D QSAR. So here I'm using four different variables. One is the relative intramolecular interaction energies. That is a delta, delta E intra and intra. Then second one is relative intermolecular interaction energies. And third one is by combining intra and inter, this is another variable. The last one is relative hydrophobic interaction energies. So I will show you in a minute how I'm, what type of agreement I will get when I use these variables. Again, same setup, the molecules, because I want to compare apples and apples. So again here, since those intra and inter, already I calculated using molecular mechanics methods. So I'm going to use same thing here. System setups and minimization protocols all are same as in case of molecular mechanics calculations. Minimization of all inhibitors and solvent, say whatever I did is same. One thing is we are taking those variables and using in QSAR. So here are the results. When you use just inter, so we got the correlation 0.65. When I use the total, that includes inter and intra, so this went to 0.75. When I use the inter and intra as separate variables, so I got 0.87. When I use this hydrophobicity contribution also, this went to 0.9. So then we use all three separately. So this is the correlation I got, 0.93. This is pretty good. So advantages, provides semi-quantitative estimates of binding affinities, much faster than free energy calculations, but slower than molecular mechanics because we got to do extra fitting here. So it works within that series of compounds. Results depend on variables used in the QSAR equation. Results depend on the accuracy of those variables. Again, the same problem with force field parameters. The last one is free energy perturbation method, which would give very good estimates. So there are five types of the free energy methods. So the first one is molecular mechanics Poisson-Boltzmann equation. This is not really a free energy, but Peter Coleman and other people who have developed, they are calling it as a free energy. But it is like a much better than our molecular mechanics calculations, but these two are not based on the rigorous theoretical methods of the free energy. So this is mostly molecular mechanics based calculation. This is based on the molecular dynamic simulations. But they do get a reasonably good agreement, much, much better than QSAR or molecular mechanics. These four methods are based on real, accurate theoretical, based on theory. So these three methods, thermodynamic integration, slow growth, the free energy perturbation, all these three methods, they use parameters based on molecular mechanics for all the inhibitors, protein, and solvent. Whereas in quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics based, so we use quantum mechanics for inhibitors, whereas for solvent and protein are same as other three methods. So that is the only difference between these three methods and these methods. Here we don't have to worry about getting the parameters for the inhibitors. Here we got to worry about getting the parameters for inhibitors. Okay, so this is the thermodynamic cycle. So this cycle, one is for calculating relative solvation free energies. This is for calculating relative binding free energies. So the delta delta G bind equal to get this one, one has the delta G2, and that means you get the free energy from here and free energy from here. So just like as a delta G in complex, delta G in aqueous phase, that will give the delta relative binding free energy between those two inhibitors. So if you want to get this relative solvation free energy, you got to do one calculation in the aqueous phase, one calculation in the gas phase. The difference between these two will give the relative solvation free energy between those two inhibitors. So one good thing about this free energy is you can decompose that free energy into enthalpy and entropy. Based on this enthalpy and entropy, one can decide whether the binding change is dominated by enthalpy or entropy. Based on that, we can change the direction. Let us say if it is completely dominated by entropy, you can make that compound more rigid, then you can reduce the entropy contribution. Let us say if this is dominated by completely enthalpy, by putting some polar groups or removing some polar groups, we can change the direction. So you, based on what is your final goal, okay? So there are several issues when you are doing free energy calculations. First one is parameters for solubility marks. How you are going to develop parameters? Are you going to use the standard parameters, whatever they have, these commercial packages? Or if, so you got to decide what type of accuracy you are expecting. Same thing here, partial atomic charges. Most of these packages, you know, they do have good partial charges, but if you want to use whatever they have, that's fine. Or if you want to get highly accurate results, so if you want to have everything under your control, you got to use your own, get your own partial charges. Then other thing is the size of the solvated box. So based on the size of your inhibitor, you got to decide what size of the box you want to use, how many water molecules you want to add. These are things, you know, it will come trial and error. It's not going to come just by doing one calculation. You got to see what type of accuracy you are getting, what size of the, you got to finalize this one by using this type of box. I am getting this much accuracy. If I increase this one, the accuracy is improving. If I reduce that one, whether you are going to low, your accuracy is going to go down or not. Those things will come, you know, by doing different calculations, by using different sizes of the box. Then cutoff distance for interactions, whether you want to use all atoms. There's so many things, you know, when you are doing, then only you are going to know these things. Then you got to do this time step. If you use SEC, then you can use a larger time stack of 2 petaseconds. If you don't use SEC, then you got to use a very small time stack that will take a lot of computer time. And also, what is the length of the minimum simulation? So based on your convergence and the accuracy of the results you are getting, you got to increase or decrease the length of simulation. Always larger the simulation, you would be better off. Then number of those. So let us say if it is a small mutation, converting the hydrogen to hydroxyl. So you can get away with a small number of windows. If it is a large mutation, you got to use more windows. Otherwise, you will have a lot of problems with convergence. Then, and also, what is the length of each window? So you want to use 10 picoseconds for equilibration, 20 picoseconds for data collections. These are all you are going to learn with trial and error. Then last, how you are going to estimate the error bars. So some people, you know, they do these calculations and they try to put a very small error bars so that, you know, people will believe these numbers are highly accurate. So there's several methods and you got to decide which method is accurate, which method is more reliable or even for calculating error bars. So when you have a small change like going from hydroxyl to hydrogen, you can get away using single topology method. It's very easy. So when you have a large mutations like that, this is a phenyl aniline to isoleucine, there's a big change. You cannot do using a single topology methods. Here you got to use double topology method. So where you have, so this is a dummy, this is real. When you get to the final compound, the dummy will become real and real will become dummy. And this is the core molecule. It's common for both, but these are the differences between those two. So this requires a lot of computer time. So, and also you got to decide, you will have some convergence problem also. When you have convergence problems, you may want to do even decompose that free energy electrostatic versus van der Waals, because by doing both same time you may get in trouble. So this type of molecule you can use as a single topology or dual topology. You can get away using any one of those methods. So I'll give one simple examples, like for calculating relative solvation energies between these three small molecules. So going to methanol to ethane, when we used only 76.5 picoseconds, we got to 36.8 kilojoules, and this is experimental number. Even error bars are very big. When I doubled that simulation, 153, so that came down quite a bit closer to experiment. Then again, by increasing like this all the way, so we have got pretty close to the experiment. So that's why when you use this free energy methods, first, you know, you got to take the one known compound in that series and use different lengths of simulation and compare with experimental data and see what is the minimum molecular dynamic simulation is required to get the reasonable experimental number. Then once you establish that protocol, you can use the same thing for all the analogs within that project. Of course, if you go to different project, different inhibitors, you may have to do it again. Same thing here. This is even a smaller change. So we're able to get 2.5 nanoseconds. We're getting pretty good agreement, closer to experiment. So this is a big change. So P to isoleucine. So even when you go to the 2.5 nanoseconds, still I have the big error bars because of the change is very big. So using the free energy, again, I'm taking all those 20 molecules, 22 molecules here. So as I said earlier, so before I go for the predictions, I'm going to validate this method for known case. Here, this is inhibitor one, this is inhibitor two. So this is a big change. This is a broken ring, we have a ring. So we thought if we can predict this one correctly, we can use the same protocol for predicting for unknowns, okay? So anyway, I don't want to spend too much time on the experimental details. So first, you know, before I use that structure for free energies, I want to make sure that protein structure is reasonably good. First, we minimize it and compare the experimental structure. All atoms, as expected, we have a little bit larger RMS deviation per backbone, better. We can consider the child chains, we have much larger than all atoms. Same dynamics, average structure was X-ray. So all these things are pretty good within the experimental variance of the X-ray structure. So that shows the structure is reasonable to use for predicting the binding affinities of the inhibitors. So here are the results. So this is going from ZMP to AMP. So we are losing about 1.5 kcal desolvation. That means this ZMP is costing more to desolve it when compared to AMP. So that's the reason the experimental number is, so most of the loss of the binding affinity is dominated by the desolvation. Because, you know, when you have that broken ring, those polar groups are picking up more interactions with water when compared to that AMP. So this completely dominated by the loss in the binding affinity here is because due to the loss of the desolvation, due to the penalty of the desolvation. So that's also, you know, whatever these results indicate that AMP binds to the EPP is about 13-fold better than ZMP. The loss in the binding affinity of ZMP is due to higher desolvation. The results suggest that TCP approach can be useful for predicting larger changes in inhibitors. These results validate the methodology and support the use of this method for screening proposed analogs of a lead compound prior to synthesis. So, same 22 molecules. So these are the results. So wherever you see this negative number, so negative, this negative number here in this column, that means the new analog is better than the lead. Wherever you see this positive number, new analog is worse than the lead. Our first goal was to convert phosphate into phosphonate. We proposed these four molecules. All four molecules are worse than expected. Especially when I did these calculations before they censored this compound, when I told them we are going to lose a lot of free energy, more than even 2000, they didn't even believe, because the change, whatever we made, was just converting one oxygen into carbon. Even I didn't even expect that we were going to lose that much. But anyway, I asked them, go ahead and synthesize all those compounds. They synthesized. The next I will discuss about this. All those four compounds are worse than we expected. So our main goal, we couldn't achieve. So anyway, I will discuss these results in the next slide. So this is the micromolar inhibitor, the starting lead compound. When you converted this one into carbon, oxygen to carbon, we lost 2,000-fold. Nobody even believed that one. Many people thought chemists didn't give the right compound. Then we asked them to go and check all their QC data. They checked and came back and said, this is almost like a 90 compound is the right compound. Even purity is 98-99%. Then we asked the biology guys to go and repeat that experiment. So they repeated 3 or 4 times and they came back pretty much an average. It's not far away whatever they reported earlier. Then it was a puzzle. So that project team, they met and they discussed about the results. Everybody agreed we should not spend any money on this project until unless we understand why we lost this 2004. So only way you can answer that question is using computational methods or theoretical methods. Experimental guys cannot answer that question. What they can do is you give the molecule, okay, for this molecule, this is the binding affinity. Beyond that, they cannot say anything. So then they asked me to look into that one and come back and explain to us why we lost 2004. I took that as a challenge. Then I went to the graphics lab. I looked at these two molecules on the computer screen, this one and this one. I noticed a geometry change when you go from oxygen to carbon. When there is a geometry change, I observed a repulsive interactions between this phosphonate versus the neighboring residues, which is causing the 2004 loss. Then that was a good thing. At least we were able to understand. So that is not going to solve anything. First, at least we are able to understand the problem. Then what is the solution? Then I got an idea. Why can't we connect that phosphonate from C8 position rather than C5 prime? Then I connected from here. When I connected, I didn't see any repulsive interactions. So based on my observations, I went to the project team meeting. I presented these results. Everybody liked my idea. Then they requested me, can you come up something? What is the optimal spacer between C8 and phosphate? Is it 2 atom or 3 atom or 4 atom? Or what is the combination of those atoms? All carbons or nitrogen carbon or carbon oxygen? So that type of thing they asked me. Based on their request, so I went back to my lab and did simple calculus. It's not like extensive things. By putting different spacers, 2 atom, and the spacer is, the distance is, but this one is about 4.8. 3 atoms, nitrogen, 2 carbons, 5.3. And 4 atoms, it's a little bit longer. Then 3 atom combination, putting the NH in the middle. And again, 2 carbons and 3 carbons. And oxygen in the middle, and it is like a ring type. So based on these calculations, I came up. So when you have the furanyl with 2 carbons in the middle, oxygen ring, So this is the lowest energy. This is the, having two carbons, and the middle oxygen is the next lowest. This is the three carbon is the third lowest, like this. Based on this information, the chemist, they synthesize some molecules. Okay, when they synthesize, so when they put this three carbon, two carbon nitrogen, this is 100 micromolar. When they, here is the difference is R is hydroxyl and this is hydrogen. When they have hydroxyl or hydrogen here, it won't make any difference. But both are in 100 micromolars. So then I took this molecule. Then I sent that one to Professor Bill Lipscomb at Harvard. He solved the structure with the new lead. So this is the lead. So this is the new structure. As you can see here, we are able to keep all the six hydrogen bonds here, and we are able to keep this six amino hydrogen bonds, and we are able to keep this N7. Basically, this sugar is doing nothing. And also N1 and N3, there's no hydrogen bonds, nothing. So when I saw this structure, I thought there's a lot of scope for improving the binding affinity. Even though this is 100 micromolar, of course, we started with the micromolar, we went to 2000 micromolar, now we are coming back to 100. Still there's improvement, it is worse than where you started, but when you consider where you are coming back from 2000, it is a 20-fold improvement. Okay, but after seeing this one, we were very encouraged. We thought we can break the lead compound. So based on the structure, so I said, you know, there are no hydrogen bonds. We wanted to get rid of this whole sugar ring here. Then we did several calculations here by putting this C-hexylethyl and going from two atoms to three carbons. So what it says is three carbon is better than the two atoms. Again, same R group, going from three atom to putting another nitrogen. Again, this three carbon is better than having nitrogen here. So usually whenever you see the negative number here, that means all the groups this side are better. Whenever you see the positive sign, it means this is better. So when you compare this three carbon versus oxygen inside, so again, this is better by 0.7 kcal. When you compare this CH2O versus 2,5-furanyl, again, this ring is better than this three oxygen. So based on this, they synthesize this compound. You can see here, when they have a linker, 2,5-furanyl and the neopentyl here and 2,5-furanyl, the linker, they got 0.8. That means from 100 micromolar, we are able to bring that one to 0.8. Still, it is not much better than where we started. We started with 1 micromolar, now we got 0.8. Still better than 1 micromolar. But when we considered from 2000 to 0.8, there's a big change. So the other thing is, as you can see here, there are no hydrogen bonds, right? That's why next we want to make some analogs on N1 and N3. So we replaced the nitrogen by CH, and also we added some nonpolar groups. So again, going from nitrogen to hydrogen and other things, we are seeing some big improvement in the binding affinity. So they took these numbers and they went back and synthesized. So from 800 nanomolar, by putting the polar here, ethyl here, and they're able to get to 55 nanomolar. So there's big improvement from 800 to 55. And with some further optimization, so this is the final compound. So this is where we started with 1 micromolar. So we went to the 2000 micromolar. From 2000, we got 60 nanomolar. As you can see here, this is the starting molecule, this is final molecule, this is completely novel molecule. Even when you overlay these two molecules, you can see here, this is coming from C8 position, whereas this original molecule is coming from C5 position. Both are going the pretty much same place. And we are able to keep up this hydrogen bonds and also this N7. And if you look at this structure, so this one, we're able to keep all six hydrogen bonds here, and N7, and this six amino two, even the nomenclature is different, we're able to keep this nitrogen bond, we're able to keep this NH2 bonds, and also this one also some electrostatic interactions. Here, you know, we got rid of the sugar, we put this group here near pentyl that is picking up a good hydrophobic interactions with hydrophobic residues. So you can see everything is complete in our molecule. So using X-ray, CAD, chemistry, and biochemistry, we're able to go from this lead compound to the final drug molecule by synthesizing about 800 molecules. Okay, the next project is HIV-1 protease. So this is the lead inhibitor. This is AIDS. So here also we want to validate that method. So this is inhibitor one and inhibitor two. So this is a big change. That too, this is not the end. We are somewhere, still we have another group at the end. So when we initiated the project, we didn't even think we were going to develop the method which can predict this one. This was a very challenging mutation. So I took that one as a challenge. So I did that mutation using dual topology method. So we got very good agreement. Just, you know, nowadays, you know, even you come up with a drug, it will be very hard to publish a paper in PNAS. In those days, just the mutation going from the inhibitor one to inhibitor two, just to that method, I was able to publish that paper in PNAS because nobody ever completed that type of mutation before 1991, such a large change. So again, comparing all atoms, backbones and side chains, they're all within the experimental errors. So even when you compare with the molecular dynamics versus X-ray, within the experimental errors. So this is the dimer. So when you consider these numbers, this is the desolvation. Even though the S1 is costing 7.73 K called extra desolvation, still this inhibitor one is better than inhibitor two. Because this valine is picking up very good interactions with the protein. Of course, it is paying a lot of desolvation penalty. So whatever positive interactions it is gaining in the binding site, are compensating the desolvation penalty. That's why inhibitor one is better than inhibitor two by more than 3.25 kcal. So again, since we validated this method, we went for unknowns. So this is the new structure. This was solved by Agaron. Again, this is that new structure by binding. This is a dimer. Again, we proposed so many analogs. So finally, so this is the starting compound. This is the final drug, which is marketed by Pfizer right now. This name is Viracept. So using X-ray crystallography, computer tools, chemistry, and biology, we're able to go from this molecule to this final drug by synthesizing about 1,000 molecules. In all cases where experimental data is available, predictions based on FEP calculations are correct. FEP methods combined with X-ray crystallography, medicinal chemistry, and biology contributed in the discovery of clinical compounds, phase two and phase three, and preclinical compounds for type 2 diabetes and one marketed drug for AIDS. The calculated results are good examples of successful application of CAD paradigm in drug discovery. So the next is advantages and limitations of current CAD methods. So, as I said, you know, the docking and scoring program, which will give crude estimates, molecular mechanics will give the qualitative estimates, and regression methods or QCR methods will give semi-quantitative estimates, and free energy calculations would provide you quantitative estimates. So unfortunate thing is all these methods required molecular mechanics force field parameters both for inhibitor and protein as well as for solvent. And your results depend on how accurately molecular mechanics force field parameters are developed. So these are all four different methods. So your results will, assuming you have excellent force field parameters, so your results will depend on the accuracy of the method. So next I will discuss how we are going to solve some of these problems. So using this novel quantum mechanics, molecular mechanics based FEV method for drug discovery. So again here, this is the inhibitor in aqueous phase, receptor in aqueous phase. During binding process, this inhibitor is going to get into the cavity of the receptor by picking the solvent out. And also one can measure binding constant K1 for inhibitor 1 and binding constant K2 for inhibitor 2. The ratios of K2 and K1 are directly related to the Gibbs free energy. If one can estimate the Gibbs free energy without making any approximations, that would become a gold standard. Even experimental guys can calibrate their experiments using these free energies. But unfortunately, we cannot solve the Schrodinger equation for more than one electron. So obviously we got to make approximations. One approximation is approximations in methods, approximations in molecular mechanics force field parameters. So I will discuss one at a time. So all these four methods, so assuming we have excellent force field parameters, this is similar to, so even if you have a bench car or a BMW, if you don't have a good driver, you get into trouble. So because that can give you some safety protection, but at the end it cannot save you. If you don't have, same thing, even having excellent method, if you don't have a good force field parameters, even the excellent method cannot give you good agreement. So that's why method is important. At the same time, your force field parameters are also very important. Both are going to play a very important role when you're looking for highly accurate results, predictions. Okay, so here, this is enthalpy and entropy, and this is a contribution of the aqueous phase. As I said earlier, we ignore all those things, and we take this just energy, especially in case of docking, they won't even do rigorous energy calculation, just a simple scores. That's why the docking programs are meant for screening millions of the compounds, not for predicting. So that's why we can get only crude estimates when you consider molecular mechanical calculations. So they ignore this, even though they include aqueous phase, they ignore the entropy and the volume term. When you ignore the entropy term and try to compare flexible molecules versus rigid molecules, that is going to create problems. When you ignore this volume term, when you try to compare the small molecules versus large molecules, then that is going to have effect. So when you ignore these two terms, we cannot expect quantitative estimates using molecular mechanics. That's where we can get only qualitative estimates. Whereas in QSR methods, even though we are ignoring indirectly during that fitting process, we are including the entropy indirectly, implicitly, and same thing, that's why one could expect semi-quantitative estimates. Whereas in free energy, everything is included. Only problem is parameters. If you don't have parameters, even use the free energy method, it doesn't matter. So this is the accuracy versus CPU. When you use the docking, the accuracy is very low, but it's very fast. Molecular mechanics, accuracy is better than docking. And computer wise, take a little bit. Same thing with the QSAR, takes a little extra computer time, but your accuracy is better than the other two methods. The free energy perturbation methods, based on molecular mechanics, force field methods. So there are a lot of academic packages, including Schrodinger and Charn, they have this molecular mechanics based on free energy methods. The QM, where we treat all the inhibitors quantum mechanically, right now, as far as my knowledge, we are the only one who are treating inhibitors quantum mechanically by treating protein or solvent using molecular mechanics. So right now, nobody has this one because it requires a lot of computer time. Only time will tell when people can implement this one. So the issue here is we have all these packages. All are required molecular mechanics force field for solvent, for protein, and inhibitors. For inhibitors, so normally they have to use this type of equation and get the parameters using quantum mechanics. In order to get these things, the user has to have knowledge of quantum mechanics. Even having a knowledge is not enough. When you plug in all these numbers, even you make a small mistake like a minus to plus, that is going to screw up your results. Of course, it takes a lot of time and also good knowledge in quantum mechanics to get this parameter. Having those things, again, it is a tedious problem and easy to make mistakes. So in order, so long back, you know, we developed the parameters for all these atoms and we got very good agreement. We had to spend about 6 months of our time to get the parameters correctly for this molecule. I was able to publish this one. But the problem is, for every molecule, it is not going to be that easy to develop parameters using quantum mechanics. It is going to take a lot of time and is not worth. To avoid that problem, what we proposed was, we wanted to treat solvent molecular mechanics. They have very good force field parameters for molecular mechanics, and they have very good force field parameters for protein residues. And only for inhibitors, we wanted to treat all the inhibitors quantum mechanically so that, you know, we can eliminate developing force field parameters quantum mechanics. Okay, there are three different methods in this package. So first approach is a little bit faster. The way we are doing is we are getting the partial atomic charges using AM1 method, and we are getting the gradients during molecular dynamics using AM1 method, and we are treating solvent and protein using molecular mechanics force fields. Second approach is we get partial atomic charges using ab initio methods, and we use the AM1 for getting gradients and molecular mechanics for treating solvent and protein. The last method is which would take extra computer time. We get all the partial atomic charges of the inhibitors using ab initio quantum mechanics method, and also we can do gradient also using ab initio quantum mechanics and treat solvent and protein using molecular mechanics methods. This would take a lot of time. So we validated these methods for simple solvation frenzy calculations that was published in 2004. Then later on, we validated this method for inhibitors, and also we got another JAX. Then again, we have validated this method for anomalous behavior, hydration of amines and amides. This also, we got really three nice good papers just for the validation. There was no prediction, nothing, just validation. So these are the results. So when you consider here, simple case, methanol to ethane. So this is using a traditional conventional free energy methods where you treat everything molecular mechanics based method. Results are in kilojoules. That's why the numbers are big. Okay, if you use the quantum mechanics, it is a 29.7. This was 31. Every single case you can see here, we're getting really good agreement. Here, you know, in those olden days, they spent a lot of time for developing the parameters for molecular mechanics. Here, you know, I could set up this calculation by spending 15 minutes of my time. So just by spending 15 minutes of time without plugging in any number, so there's no scope of making any errors, and I was able to get better agreement. So in every single case, as you can see here, from methanol to ethane to even this DNA base. So again, same thing here. We use it for predicting relative binding affinities or APPS inhibitors. So this one, earlier, so we were able to do this one using conventional methods. So by developing parameters in our lab. So we got a very good agreement. We got one JAX paper on that. Then again, using this same method. So we validated this one. Every single case, we got a good agreement. Again, we got another JAX communication. Just the same thing using the old method and a new method. Nothing else, We got two JAX papers on that. So that means there's a lot of value in this type of technology. Otherwise, just for predicting, nobody would accept in JAX. That too, publishing in JAX Communication. So this is a large, completely diverse set of the molecules. So even going from ribose to H is a big change. Even such a big, large changes, we are able to get very good parameters, very good agreement with experiment. As you can see here, this is 1.4, this is 1.3. So the experimental is 0.9. Even here, hydrogen to cyclohexyl, this is also a big change. And so even phenyl to cyclohexyl ethyl, these are all large changes. It's not like just going from oxygen to hydrogen or something like that. These are all big changes. In every single case, you can see top to bottom, we're able to get a very good agreement. Of course, this one done by using a molecular mechanics method, free energies. This is like using quantum mechanics where we treated inhibitors quantum mechanically. So the other thing is, you know, anomalous hydration behavior of simple alkyl amines and amides. Why is it important? So amines and amides functionality commonly found, if you take all the drug molecules, 80% of the drug molecules, they contain either amine or amide. So unfortunately, most of the packages, they cannot even predict the properties of the amine and amides correctly. The other thing is, now even for hit identification, validation, so because you are going to have this, you cannot get away any organic molecules without amine and amide somewhere. So when you go from NH3 to NH, replacing one of the hydrogens by methyl group, so using conventional methods, they got 0.62. Because what this is telling is, when you replace my hydrogen by methyl group, there's more hydrophobic. That's what anybody would expect. But whereas experiments are telling, this is a hydrophilic, not hydrophobic. So they didn't even get the sign right. When they replace all the three hydrogens by three methyl groups, this is 4.36. Experiments are telling this is less hydrophobic. This is highly hydrophobic. So still, even though they got qualitatively in the right direction, but quantitatively they're off quite a bit. Same thing with amide analogs. So when they replace one of these hydrogens by methyl group, the calculations is showing 2.09 kcal. That means this is a highly hydrophobic, whereas experiments are telling -0.4. They didn't even get this sign right. When they replace all the two hydrogens by two methyl groups, this is 3.1. So even though they got sign right, they're up quite a bit. So these are the methods, these are the results using this quantum mechanics based free energies. So this is experiment. This is using quantum mechanics method, this is the conventional method. They didn't even get the sign right, but we got it right. Same thing here. When they replace these things in every single case. So we are able to get, this is the experiment, this is our method, this is conventional method. They're up by quite a bit. So again here, for amide analogs, they didn't even get the sign right. We got a very good agreement, both analogs. So this is very interesting case for drug discovery project. So if I had used a conventional method, so if you consider this solvation phenolity, so using a conventional method, it is showing to replace one of the hydrogen groups by methyl group would cost 1.9 kcal. Whereas using the quantum mechanics, it is showing only 0.5 kcal. That means we are up by more than 1 kcal just here itself in solvation. The same thing is reflecting when it comes to the binding energies. So when you consider the binding free energy of experimental, it's 1.4. Whereas using this quantum mechanical based free energy, 1.2. Using molecular mechanics free energy, 0.3. So if I had believed this free energy method using a molecular mechanics based method, I would say whether I have this hydrogen or methyl, both are same. That's what the experiment is telling. Since I use the quantum mechanics, I was able to understand, replacing this hydrogen by methyl group, you are going to lose 1.2 kcal, which is agreeing with experimental lantern. So whenever you have this, so amino groups are amides, you know, so when your program cannot predict salvation of energies correctly, that will have a significant effect on your final prediction. Same thing here. Of course, when you don't have this, just going from NH2 to chloro, then we are getting very good agreement using this method. Only problem is, here we are replacing the complete thing, amino by chloride, because there's nothing like replacing one group. So this is very important to have a good program which would predict properties of the amines or amides accurately. Otherwise, you get in trouble. Okay, this is a historical perspective of CAD. In olden days, 1960 or something, the mostly crystallographers, they use ball and stick models to explain those molecules. The accuracy is 50%, 51%. The reason I'm telling is, you come to me with the two molecules, if you ask me to predict which one is better, I don't have to do anything. Just I can take the lottery and say, oh, this is better, because already 50% is in your hand. There's no science there. So by using the semi-empirical methods, so the accuracy went up 55 to 65. By using docking, molecular mechanics, and QSR methods, this is all, there's nothing like written in the literature. This is all my experience, my friend's experience. That's how I came up with rough estimate. There's nothing like hardcore number here. So 65 to 75, then using molecular mechanics, force fields, and free energy methods, the accuracy went up to 75 to 90%. So even now many academic professors and some industries are using this method. Using quantum mechanical method, we're able to bring that accuracy to 90-95%. So when you use complete quantum mechanics, this may go up, but it's going to take a lot of computer time. So these are the publications which described all the results. Next one is a flowchart for clinical development. Using all those computer techniques and medicinal chemistry and biology, all those things, you know, once you identify a clinical candidate, first thing is do preclinical studies in animals. If the results are promising, go for phase one clinical trials. Mostly phase one is a small 50 to 100 people looking safety as well as safe dose range. If results are promising, go to phase two, where you can do 200 to 400 people looking both safety and efficacy. And if results are promising, go to phase three. That's where you do 1,000 to 2,000 patients and looking both the safety, efficacy, as well as comparing the existing drugs. If results are promising, then you collect all the data and submit to FDA, and the advisory panel will review, and they will decide whether the drug is approved or not. Even after FDA approval, you got to do phase four studies, looking for long-term side effects, as well as for new indications. So these are the drugs. So which were discovered in help of, by using the CAD help. Doesn't mean we pressed the button, they got the drug. CAD played an important role. So I'm missing, I don't think I included all the latest drugs. This is a little bit outdated slide. As you can see here, this is the drug name. This is the structure of these compounds. This is the disease name. This is the protein target where this drug was designed. Then this is the company name who is marketing these drugs. As I said, this is the Viracept we discovered at Agron. Later on, we sold that company to Pfizer. That's why that Pfizer is marketing the drug as part of the cocktail treatment. So same thing, you know, different drug names, different structures, different indications, all those things. If anybody's interested, I'm more than happy to provide these slides. So again, these are all the things here. So again, you know, recent survey indicated that there are more than 400 drug candidates discovered with the help of CAD methods, which are undergoing at various stages of clinical development studies for indications such as cancer, diabetes, viral diseases, cardiovascular, and anti-inflammatory. Only time will tell how many of these drugs will get into market. So these are the people with whom I worked and who helped me. So Mark Arian and UC Singh, I worked with them for almost 20 years. These are my collaborators from University of Hyderabad. So Rathur, Kumar, and Professor Redena, we have a lot of joint publications. So the docking work was done by Kumar and Rathur. So, and also we worked with Aparai and Konapi. And these are the people from Lesson Labs. And these are the people who work at Metabasis. These are the people who solved those taxes at Harvard University. With this, once again, I would like to thank organizers. And if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to answer. Hello?
Thank you, Dr. Rami Reddy, for this wonderful session. And I would also request the participants, if they have any questions, please, this is the time to ask your questions, get your doubts clear. So please go ahead and unmute yourself and ask the question that you have.
Good afternoon, Dr. Rani.
Yes.
Thank you very much for the lecture. My question would be, for someone who is new to computer-aided drug discovery, what would you recommend as a starting point? I mean, I'm asking this because for most of your lecture, I was lost. While I could understand some of the terms you were talking about, for most of the other terms you were mentioning, I didn't understand. So I would like to request you to tell us what can actually be the starting point for someone who is new into this field.
Okay, so if you want to be successful in this structure-based drug discovery, I would recommend you should get the structure of that complex to start with. Your predictions are going to be more accurate and your success rate will be very high. If you don't have that structure of the complex with the lead inhibitor, so whatever circus we do, we may be able to help a little bit, but at the end, the computers, the chemists and biology guys, they're going to play more important role than computational chemists. If you have the structure, you can use the structure, even you can identify the hit and you can convert that hit into lead. Then using whatever the techniques I discussed, you can optimize that lead. You can do a lot of things when you know the structure.
Okay.
When you don't know the structure, using QSR method or ligand-based methods, in my opinion, they would play some important role, but your success rate is not going to be as good as having the structure of the target.
Okay. Knowing the structure of the active sites.
Yeah, active site, structure of the protein, preferably with complex. Solving the structure with one of the lead inhibitors. That would have a lot of effect on your drug discovery projects.
Thank you very much.
All right, if anyone else have anything to ask. Okay, if you don't have any questions, then I think you can also email Dr. Reddy, right? Dr. Reddy, they can email you.
Yeah, sure. So you can get my email from the organizers. You can write me anything. If you don't feel like asking now, I'm more than happy to answer your questions. If you want, I'm more than happy to share my presentation.
Thank you so much, sir. That would be wonderful. And thank you for the presentation and all the topics that you covered. We got a really great overview of how we are going to progress now into the upcoming sessions. So we already have the session scheduled and everything shared. So if anyone here have any questions and confusions about registration and how do you go ahead, please let me know. I'll be able to show you that. If not, then we will be meeting again tomorrow for the next session. And till then, I think please go through the video. We will be sharing this video recording with you. And also the video recording of the previous session has been shared. So we'll be looking forward for your participation in the next session. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Hello, Dr. Reddy, can you end the meeting for all? You're the host.
Yeah, sorry, I want to end. Okay.
Thank you.